that you bless us as sons and daughters of you. And if there's anybody that's here that doesn't know you, I pray that they would. And I pray that you please bless us and lead us and all good things. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Willow Creek this morning, both here in our sanctuary and online. We're grateful that you chose to worship with us today. If you happen to be a visitor, please fill out the visitor information card so that Pastor can reach out and get in touch with you. Also, a reminder, offering plates are in the back of the sanctuary. So if you feel led, you can find those on the small table in the back. Light refreshments immediately following service, and Sunday school class down the hallway to my right. Start around 11 a.m. From your bulletin, I'd like to pull out our mission of the quarter is Hannah's House. Also, the basket is in the lobby always for donations for the Mac food pantry. And there always seems to be a need there. So if you are blessed, share with others, please. We have moved our combined council meeting. It will now fall on Tuesdays. So this coming week, on Tuesday the 21st at 7 p.m. will be our combined council meeting. Our next all-church breakfast is June the 8th. And as most of you know, there are lots of graduations going on around the area right now. It is a tradition here at the Creek that we honor graduates. So if you have a family member, be it a child or a grandchild who is graduating from high school or from college, please get that information to me as soon as possible. I would like a picture, the name, and the school that they are graduating from, if possible. So a photo, a name, and the school that they're graduating from, if you could get that to me as soon as possible. And also, if you are a parent with a child transitioning from third grade to fourth grade, so if your child is ending third grade this year, if you could please get that information to me as well, a photo and their name, I would appreciate it. Are there other announcements this morning? Just a reminder that the pastor and his wife have graciously opened the parsonage for an open house this afternoon from 2 to 4, I believe. 2 to 4 p.m. And that parsonage is located on Wild Game Drive in Osceola. It's in Pheasant Point Subdivision. So you can get to it from off of Jefferson, or you can get to it from off of McKinley. But remember that McKinley's under some pretty major construction right now, so I would recommend that you go the Jefferson route. Might take you a little less time. Would you bow with me in prayer this morning? Our gracious God and Heavenly Father, we are grateful. We are grateful to be here to worship in freedom. Yesterday was Armed Services Day to honor all branches of the military, and we are thankful for those who, even today, put their life on the line so that we can live in a country that's free. Father, we pray that you would bless this service to your honor and glory, each word from each mouth that participates today. And may the person who needs to hear it the most hear it, and the person that think they need to hear it the least hear it as well. In Jesus' name, amen.
Will you please stand as we begin to worship the Lord together in song?
Look full in his wonderful
Amen. Will you turn and greet your neighbors, please?
Good morning.
Morning. Guess we're waving today, right? All right, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Oh, boy, that wasn't very awe-inspiring. Good morning.
Good morning.
All right, very good. Good to see all of you here today. It's good to be together in the house of the Lord and to be together as his family. So let's see, a couple of things to think about. As we said, yes, there is an open house at the parsonage today, and yet you're invited to be there. We have lots of cake, in fact, an obscene amount of cake. And so if you don't come and eat it, well, I guess the kids will, and I really don't want that to happen. So they're going to be bouncing off the walls and things like that. So cake and punch and other good things will be there, and you're invited to be there. And hey, if you want to hang out for 10 minutes or more than that, you're all welcome to do so. And it's kind of, again, our way of saying thanks for allowing us to be a part of this church family. Of course, as you know, this is the time of our service where we get the opportunity to be able to share whatever's on our hearts, maybe things that we want prayers about, things that we want the body of Christ to know and that we can be able to burden together with. Would anybody like to get us started about something that they would like to share on their heart this morning? Yes, Shirley.
I like Traveling Mercies for Victoria.
Okay, for Victoria.
I never advised her to go to Las Vegas, but I did the Grand Canyon, so.
Okay, yeah.
A picture, but I said it'll take your breath away.
Yeah.
So she's tasked to be traveling tomorrow.
Okay, very good. And safety there, especially if you go to the bottom, which I heard is quite an experience. So one day trek's down there. I've never done it. Maybe in the future I'll take my wife there, right? And she can't make a face at me. So anybody else have anything they would like to share this morning?
I'm back behind you, Pastor. I just asked for prayers. In the next couple of weeks, I have some upcoming testing going on. For medical testing, as well as again with my tooth. I'm back on another antibiotic for the same tooth. And then a praise, my grandson Michael, as most of you know, is in the Penn Marching Band and is a very talented musician. And he was invited to play at a concert at Goshen College this afternoon with only 5 other members of the Penn Band.
Wow.
So I'm extremely, extremely excited
That's
for him
awesome.
For that opportunity.
Wow, what an opportunity. Thank you for sharing that with us. Anybody else have something they would want to share with others? Maybe something the Lord has done that's really amazing and you want to share about? Nothing's too small. Devin, are you raising your hand there? He said, absolutely not. I imagine not. So. All right, if there is nothing else this morning, let's take these, Lord, in prayer and just thank him for this morning. Father, we do thank you for this morning. We know that just getting up is really just a means of your grace. Sometimes just our feet hitting the floor, we can say, thank you, Lord, that we can do this. We can get up or that we can be emotionally strong. And even if we are not, Lord, we thank you that you're never very far away from us. We thank you that we can speak to you, whether it is the coldest of nights or the darkest of them or even the earliest of mornings. We never get your voicemail, so to speak, that you're always available to us and we can bring you all the good things or all the things that we are frustrated with and that we can lay them before your feet. So, Father, we thank you for the good things of our church. I pray that you continue to work at Willow. And thank you for these last few weeks. I'm just really grateful for them, whether we're celebrating mothers or we're celebrating graduates or whatever it is. We have a lot of things to celebrate, whether we recognize it or not. And just even being able to show up this morning on Sunday morning, Lord, that is actually a very great praise. We have open doors, we have seats, we have air conditioning. That may seem like some very small things, but actually it's not. The very fact that we even have Bibles that we can read that's in our own language and that we even have the ability to read them is quite something that is praiseworthy. And so we want to thank you for every good thing in which you're doing, not only in our lives, but also in the life of our church. We pray for those that are at home. Whatever it is, I pray that you'd meet them where they are. We pray for those that couldn't be here for whatever reason.
Pray that they know that they're always welcome here at this church and that they never have to be far away. We thank you, Lord, for leading us and guiding us, and pray that you continue to help us during this service today. And we pray and ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, would you stand as we sing together the doxology? So I got to say that this morning.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You may be seated.
Pastor's sermon title this morning is Contagious Christianity. It's kind of hilariously ironic, maybe, that in my trustee's inbox this morning, I opened an envelope from our insurance company that insures the church, and we are being insured against contagious, widespread pandemic-type diseases. Contagious Christianity is not one of those things, so let's be contagious Christians. Our scripture lesson is 1 Thessalonians chapter 1.
Verse 1?
Just one verse.
That's one verse?
Just one verse. Just that right there.
Oh. Okay. So
not the whole thing. Just okay. The very first verse.
Okay. So there was a correction. It's 1 Thessalonians verse 1, chapter 1, verse 1. Just one verse. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the Church of the Thessalonians, in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. This is the word of God for the people of God.
And so obviously there was a little bit of confusion concerning that. I don't know that I was as clear as I should have been with that, but what we're actually doing today is that we're actually starting on a series of sermons going through the book of 1 Thessalonians. And the whole thing is going to be called Contagious Christianity. So this as a whole, that's what it is. I thought about naming it Authentic Christianity so we wouldn't have the negative connotations of being contagious, like Ruth mentioned. But still, nonetheless, you get the idea of what this is and what we're looking at. And so I like to do these book studies. I know we haven't done one together before. I always try to do it in the thought of being, you know, merciful in the sense like it's not going to be so short like what today is. Like a lot of times we're going to take sections. We're going to preach through those. When we need to take a break, we will certainly do so. So that we can be able to learn the word of the Lord together, because it's very important for us as God's people to be able to go through God's word systematically. Now, that seems maybe strange or maybe it's hard, but honestly, if you ever open up your Bible, guess how you're going to read it? You're probably going to read through a book. And so what this ends up doing is it makes us go through all the passages, and God sets the pace for what it is that we are to learn. We're going to cover things that are easy, things that are going to challenge us, and passages that maybe that we are tempted to jump over or to ignore. We face those because, honestly, if you're reading these, you're going to have questions of your own. And so when we go through books like this, it makes us go through all those things so that we can struggle through those things together. It sounds like a bad thing, but I assure you that in the struggle, that is where we grow. And so you're right, this morning is only a single verse. For the totality of all these sermons, which I only hope that these are only about like, I don't know, maybe 6 to 8 weeks. Again, we'll probably take a break in the middle so that we just have a different direction every once in a while. But we're going to be reading through the Christian Standard Bible for that. And the reason being is it is a very easy to read translation. So when you read through it, Paul, if you've ever read through Paul before, he can be very wordy. And sometimes he is hard to follow. And I find, at least for the Christian Standard Bible, that it makes it pretty easy to follow along and I really appreciate the way in which it comes to things. And so that's where we're going to be today. So yes, a single verse, but I assure you, we're going to be heading in a good direction for all this. So as a kind of an introduction, that when I was a young Christian and I was listening to sermons, going through the book of 1 Thessalonians was actually the first study that I ever did. Now, we went through it and we studied it, and I understood at least part of it, because I can't say that I understood all of it, certainly being a young Christian. But one of the things that I gathered from it was that this is a very good book, that there's a lot of authenticity with that. And with authenticity, there's a lot of attraction to a Christian who is genuine in things in which they do. And so this study, when I listened to it, was given by the renowned radio preacher Chuck Swindoll. If you've not heard of him, he's probably the most famous of all radio preachers in the nation, or at least that he was. And so he walked us through this book, and he actually used the same title. So you're right, I am stealing a little bit, but because I couldn't think of a better name, just saying Contagious Christianity, because it gives us an idea that we as Christians can, in many ways, can be attractive to those that are outside the faith. And there's a lot of good things in this book that show us what a genuine Bible-believing Christian really looks like. And we're not as intimidating as people might think. One of the main lessons that Chuck Swindoll, of course, emphasized as he went through a book like this was that this was an authentic kind of church. It says that a church with maybe with all the frills or all the bells and whistles that maybe that we're accustomed to, but there is a genuineness in so much so that this church, being what it was actually an example to other churches that was in the region. I mean, how would you like to be basically the poster child for other churches that are around you? That they would look up and say, hey, if you want to know about what a good church looks like and what faithfulness looks like, all you need to go to is the church of Thessalonica. Or even in our times, we could say, hey, go to Willow Creek. That is a place in which you can find authentic Christians living out real faith. They're actually expressing a lot of love. And you can see about how amazing that would be, that we would not just have an influence here, but we had to have an influence all over the place. In fact, even though that we didn't get to read it this morning, I am doing a little bit of jumping ahead. If you're in that book, that Paul actually talks about how this church has been very, I guess, I don't know the lack of the right word, of just kind of being pervasive in the area, so much so that other people were looking at this church as an example for what they were supposed to be. Down in verse 7, Paul writes this. He says, as a result, you became an example to all believers. And so that's really good, right? An example that is to others. But he says, in Macedonia and in Achaia. And so he said, it's not just that you're just here in this town or that you're here in this city, that you're having an impact over all of these regions that are around you. He goes on in verse 8, he said, for the word of the Lord has rang forth from you, not only in Macedonia, but in every place your faith in God has gone out. And so it's like a picture of being on a megaphone, that their faith that they're living out is this church is actually being sounded forth, that people are hearing it, again, not just simply within their town limits, but in regions and in places, so that when Paul actually talks about them, he said, you really actually don't have to really almost do more than what you're doing, because your faith is being sounded out everywhere. To get a picture of what that would be like for us is, imagine for yourself that you were to go to a family reunion down in maybe Indianapolis, and you're getting together and you're meeting with family and people that you haven't seen for a really long time, maybe relatives that you only see maybe at every reunion, and one of those relatives stops you and says, hey, aren't you a part of that Willow Creek church? I'm not talking about the one in Chicago that everybody gets you mixed up with. I'm talking about Mishawaka, Indiana. Aren't you a part of that church? You know, I've heard some really good things about that place. I don't know everything about it. I know it's no bits and pieces and things, but I can tell that God is working in you. And you would be stunned by that because you would just say, why on earth would a place like Indianapolis or Greenwood or some places that are far away from us, why would they hear about us? And maybe in many ways we would think, maybe even why would they care unless there's something that is really powerful that is happening there. And so it's the same way with this church, is that this is, in many ways, probably a relatively small church. And that what it is doing is that it is widespread, not only in its community, but even stretching out in different regions to the provinces of Macedonia and to Achaia and all these other sorts of places, that their faith has gone out and that they're being an example to others and how that they should live and how they should act. And you would say, well, that sounds impossible, or that's something that maybe could never end up happening. But honestly, it shouldn't happen even for a church like this. It's so small. It's in this huge city, which we'll talk about in a little bit. But they are just overwhelmed with all these things. And the only way for them to have the powerful effect to which they do is if God's hand is there, if he is there helping them to do the things which they're doing. And don't we want to be a church where God's hand is at? Don't you? I mean, I do. And sometimes we can look around at maybe limitations or things in which we can't do. But in truth, if God is with us, no matter how big the battle may be or how imposing the foes may be, that we're able to move forward because he is with us, enabling us and strengthening us. And for me and for my desire for a church like ours is I would like for our church to kind of be the epicenter, the place where the gospel of Jesus is explained, but also a place in which authentic Christianity is played out, which I think that we do in large part, but I think this book actually shows us how vital that really is to us. To give you a little bit more information about this book, because you may not be familiar with it, is that this is likely one of the first, if not the very first, books that were written in the New Testament. And so you can look at it and say that this letter was written shortly after Paul's visit to this region, to this city of Thessalonica. And he wrote it shortly thereafter that he came there, he established a church, he had all these believers that came. And so that this is dated somewhere around 50 AD, so about 20 years after Jesus died and that he arose and that he ascended into the heavenly places. That's about when it is written. And so a lot of the New Testament books weren't written by this point. This was maybe the very first of the ones in which Paul has written, depending on how it's dated. But again, it's about in that area, making it the first of very many books that are in the New Testament. Paul wrote these young Christians basically to encourage them. He wanted to be able to tell them that you're on the right path, that you actually have a good and genuine faith. I know that you need a lot of help and direction for what you're doing, but guess what? You're doing a lot of good things, to remind them that they're to live with integrity and to impurity, and how that they should go there in the future with themselves. Because again, this place is relatively young in the way in which it came to be about. The city of Thessalonica, just by itself, you can actually look it up on the map, and the city still exists today. It is there, of course, in modern-day Greece. It is on the eastern side. So if you can imagine modern-day Turkey, that is, of course, over here for you guys, heading west from there, that there at Greece, you would actually be able to see a city with the same kind of name. This city has been around for a very long time. It was established in 316 BC with the then leader of Cassander joining 26 villages together to be able to establish this single city. It is located on the Aegean Sea. making that it is a port city, which connected to the Mediterranean Sea, of course, would be able to get everything out. And because of its location, that is the intersection of roads, sea traffic, and all the sorts of other things that make this a very substantial kind of town. This was a town or a city, mind you, that since its inception at 300 BC, basically grew like gangbusters. It became famous. It became great in size, partially because it had the ability to trade from Macedonia into the entirety of the Roman Empire. And so it was like a gateway city. If you wanted to go from one side from Macedonia into the Roman Empire, you were probably going through this town in one way or one shape or form. This was a big place, a huge place. This was, again, a place where people were, where legislators would have been. People of prestige and different kinds of backgrounds would have been living in this city. As Bible commentator Gene Green noted in his commentary on this book, he says that travelers would come to Thessalonica to engage in governmental affairs. They would do business. They would go to festivals and games of various different kinds, or even the spread of philosophy and religion. It was kind of like the melting pot of that area. Other places by Strambo, a renowned philosopher and geographer, said this. He said that Thessalonica is, quote, is the metropolis for where Macedonia is. It could be considered the capital city of that region. And so it's a massive in size. Some estimates put this city at boasting over 100,000 people at this time. That makes it twice the size of the recent record is what Mishawaka, Indiana is, where we're just over 50,000 people. You double that, and that is the possible size of what this town is. So it's huge. It is just huge and almost beyond comprehension that all these people were there, and they're coming there to do trade and to exchange ideas and to do all these sorts of things. And so it was very natural for Paul and his companions to go there, that if they wanted the gospel to go out to the ends of the earth for everybody to be able to hear it, that they would go to a city like this so that it could go out. You say that from this sounds really good, it sounds really wonderful, but we had to understand that when the faith of Jesus actually comes to this town, initially, it is not immediately received by all. It just isn't. In fact, if you actually read the account for when Paul comes to this town in Acts 17, that there are some that when Paul comes, they receive it. There's others that they outright reject it. And there's even some, they get so angry that Paul has come with his companions, that they actually stir the city up into an uproar, probably seeking to tear them limb from limb. We actually can look back at that in Acts 17 when Paul comes to this city on his second missionary journey, that they are repelled out of the city of Philippi, of course, where we get Philippians, and so that they come to this area having received this Macedonian call that they should come. And so they come, and as Paul has often done, is that he goes to the synagogue, which would be kind of like the local place where you share ideas and things like that. And for three Sabbaths, so basically three straight weekends, he comes, and from the scriptures, he argues with them, not as an argument sense, but kind of defending the fact that Jesus is the Christ, he is the only way to heaven, and that he is trying to show them from the Bible that he is the fulfillment of everything that God has so promised. And if you look over in that story, that there were some that they received it. Others, they just simply wouldn't. But it actually tells us much later is that some of them responded with jealousy, and their responses were downright wicked in nature. It says there in Acts 17 in verse 5, he said the Jews were jealous. That's what they were. They were jealous of what Paul, maybe his attention and all the things which he was getting. And he says, and taking some of the wicked men, they formed a mob and they set the city in an uproar. Now again, take that picture, maybe upwards of 100,000 people forming a brute squad or some sort of mob that's in their midst, making it so that the whole city was coming undone because of these men and what they were sharing and how dangerous this would have been. I mean, could you imagine Mishawaka, Indiana, being in an uproar about anything? Dad was telling me just a few years ago that, I guess, here in the city, in the area, that they put down about 200 geese in the area. He said, you should have heard the uproar concerning that. He said, this is so much worse. You get the whole city being an uproar, and sometimes with mobs and mob mentalities, people just join in, whether they know what's going on or not, because whatever is being pushed against, a lot of times people want to be part of, even if they don't understand it. It becomes very violent, almost to the point that when they go looking for Paul and his companions, they can't find them. And so what do? Is they find a man by the name of Jason, who is a recent convert, and they find other Christians, and they drag them out into the streets. They drag them before authorities, and the accusation is this: these men who have turned the world upside down have come here too. You see, they had heard about this Christianity already. They know that what it ends up doing to a lot of places. They know it causes stirs and divisions and arguing and things like that. They said, we've heard about that from other places. It's come here like a terrible contagion in the negative sense. And the reality is what they're saying is these Christians are troublemakers. We need to get rid of them. And we don't want anything that they're trying to get into our hearts. And it becomes so violent that even though that Jason and some of these early church members were allowed to leave, it became so bad that Paul and his companions had to set out, they had to leave, and they basically had to leave a church that they had established over maybe 1 month's time. It's not a lot of time, is it? You plan a church, you want to be able to pour into this. And again, they're not like kind of Christians already. It's like these are coming out of paganism. They're coming out of idol worship. They're coming out of all these things. And Paul is forced to leave with these newborn baby Christians who maybe don't know a whole lot. They're just established by themselves. He's got to leave. And guess what? They've got to figure out a lot of stuff on their own. It's very concerning, isn't it? In fact, you just say, how is this even possible? But somehow, by God's grace, they grow. They start making an impact beyond their city limits. People start talking about the good that's in the church. You might start thinking, well, I get that. Like, that makes sense, but That's a book from 2,000 years ago. We're living in a 21st century, a 21st century church. We got church problems of various different kinds. Why are we spending all this time on this? And I think part of the reason I want us to spend time on this is it's really simple, is we have more in common with them than you may realize. We just do. The first of those is that we, too, are in many ways a relatively new church. I mean, I know you'd say, oh, well, that's not really true. Like, we've been here for decades. I mean, we've been sitting on the corner. We've been here. And I get that. But as far as who we are and what we've transitioned to, we're not starting from ground zero, but we're not starting way up here. We're kind of having to figure things out all over again. You see, we used to have that denominational alignment. We don't have that anymore. We now have gone to kind of a connexial system of governing our church to now we're self-governed, right? We have a lot of questions, and you know, a lot of times we were told what to do or what we were to believe, but we don't have that now. Now we've got to start seeking and saying, hey, what is it that we really believe? You know, like, what does the Bible actually say about this? I mean, I've had this question answered for me for the last 20, 30, 40 years, but can I find that in the Bible? Is that scriptural? And you just have to start thinking and reevaluating where you've been and where you need to go. Where a lot of ways we're new, just like them, and they had a lot of question marks, probably more question marks than answers, and that they actually had to start looking and finding the answers to these things. And for them, they didn't have too many people to be able to hold their hand. They just didn't. So yes, they are a relatively new church. In many ways, I would imagine they're probably a relatively small church. But they're in a small church in this metropolitan kind of area. I mean, upwards of 100,000 people. I mean, they must feel like a drop in the bucket. Like, here's all these people, all these places. How is this church going? Maybe 100, maybe 1,000, I don't know, but that's not even being 1% of 100,000 people that were there. And I think that in many ways, we can feel the same way. We're like, we're Willow Creek. We're kind of small. How are we going to make an impact on 50,000 people in Mishawaka or Osceola or South Bend or all these other places when we're getting close to 200,000 people in all these areas? And we're sitting there going, how on earth are we even going to begin to do this? And we feel overwhelmed and we feel like it's impossible. There's no way for us to really have an impact. But here was a church led by the hand of God, and they did. And I believe that we can do this same thing. I really do. I mean, I wouldn't say that if I didn't believe it. My kids know that I just don't say things to say things. I just never have. If I've said it, it's not because I'm just trying to be super nice. I mean, I do try to be nice in many ways, but like, I'm just not here to flatter people. I don't flatter people, but if I tell you, you look nice today, or I love those flowers, or wow, that was really great, you can be sure that it's from me. I'm telling you the truth. I'm not just going to build you up just to build you up. But I do believe that God has here for this small church, it may feel as if they're lost and they're heading in various different directions, that their impact was able to go to Macedonia and Achaia, and that is still possible for the hand of God to do today. And then the third of these is that we too are working within a city with previous held religious beliefs and general religiosity. What do I mean by that is, like, a lot of times I think that, I do it anyways, is that we come to a text and we see Christianity and they get planted in this city and they get planted in this city and they do all these things. And what I think we naturally assume is it's a vacuum, it's empty, there's nothing there. And suddenly it's just like, well, Christianity just gets dropped in there, it makes sense, but it's not actually the case. This is a city of Thessalonica that's filled with all sorts of paganism. We get to read later about how that they turned away from idols to the true and living God. There's everything from, you know, philosophers and thinkers of various different kinds. We can actually see that in some of the scholar works, they actually believe that everything from Greek mythology to even beliefs in Egyptian gods were here. And of course, with a city with all these different beliefs and all these things and this melting pot of ideas and all these sorts of things, you would say, how on earth can Christianity come to a place like that and make an impact? But we are not really all that different. We are a culture that in many ways that we've been pervaded by the Roman Catholic Church. And I'm not saying it's necessarily a bad thing, but that's the culture, even if we don't recognize it. We can go down the street and we can find Mormon churches. We can find Muslims. We can find Methodists. I mean, all these sorts of things. We can find atheists, agnostics. We can even see that there's a rise of witchcraft. It's even in the culture. If you don't know that it's happening, it is. I mean, we're kind of the center of this slurry mess of stuff where people are believing a little bit of this, a little bit of that, and they're just kind of smashing all together. And that's what we're in. And if God can open the hearts of these guys in this city where there's paganism and idols on every street corner, just be sure God can work in a church like ours, even if we look out and say, I don't even know how we're going to attack it. You don't. You hang on to God, and you basically tell people what God has already said. And so that's a really long introduction, and you're right. It's not all going to be like that, okay? I promise. One of the things that I do want to focus on with this single verse, and we just got a little bit of time for this, is that I do want to look at this. You know, this one verse where it says to Paul, it's also Silvanus or Silas is awesome translated. And Timothy, it says to the church of God of the Thessalonians and God the Father and Lord Jesus Christ, grace and peace to you. Seems like a very ordinary introduction if you read through any of the books. But I believe that's within there. We actually see one of the reasons that this church or any church can actually grow. And it's in two words. It's in the words grace and peace. So, well, what does that have to do with anything? Like, we've been talking about making an impact and doing all these sorts of things. Well, let's think about it for a moment. He's saying, what I pray for you is that not only would you receive grace, but you'd receive it more and more. Okay, that's the idea. That's the picture in which he has. You have grace, you have peace, but may God begin to maximize it in you. Okay, so you need it more and more. And so what is grace? I mean, just ask yourself the question, what is grace? In the shortest terms, you could say that grace is God giving us strength and mercy. Just think about that for a moment. God's grace is what saves us. God's grace is what we need to be able to get into the kingdom of God. We don't produce this grace in ourselves. It is God who gives to us grace, and this grace is a stabilizing element for us. It gives us strength when we simply aren't strong, and grace is not a one-time event, as if we only need it when we're saved and we never need God's grace ever again. No, God's grace is something that we need every single day. I like to make things as simple as possible. So I thought of a single word to say what grace is, and that's help. It's help. What is God's grace? It is God helping us. A lot of times, because we can't help ourselves. Grace means that we can get up in the morning. Grace means that we can go on and to be strong. Grace means I can carry on to be faithful, even when I in my own strength can't. It is the Lord's help. It's Him sending to us things that we need. And if you've got a city or a town that seems so overwhelming or whatever battle it is, guess how much help you're going to need from God? Just about everything He can give to you. We are a people of grace. We are a people of needing always more grace. We need Him to help us every single day. And this church will not go anywhere without God's grace. It just won't. We need His help all the time. But He also says to us, He said, not only do you need grace and may it be more abundant to you all the more, but He said, also in peace. You say, well, what about peace? Like, we didn't think about peace signs or we didn't think about general peace, but He's talking about, of course, that peace that is for the soul. It is a peace between man and God. It is a knowledge that through Jesus Christ, the hostility between us and God has been dissolved because Christ died for us. Maybe to help you to think about why we need peace is, what does it look like when we don't have peace? What's the opposite of peace? It's fear. It's anxiety. It's just like, I don't know what to go and do. And I'm so fearful and overwhelmed and all these sorts of things. And I can tell you that any church or any Christian that is filled up to the max of just fear and anxiety and the peace of God doesn't overwhelm everything, you don't go anywhere because you're going to be too fearful. I'm fearful to share this Jesus because I don't know what people are going to think or how they're going to feel. Or, you know, I'm still trying to work things out. I'm anxious in myself. But what happens when you are at peace is it's a relief. It's like, ah, I can do this. And where does they say both of these things come from? It comes directly from the hand of God. We need God's grace every day. We need his peace to be increasing all the time. And we seek after that and say, Lord, please fill me with your grace. Help me to have the grace that seeks to help others. But help me to have a peace in my heart so that I can be able to share with others the same peace that you've given to me. And that is why grace and peace begins every letter, because all of us need it. And we need it all the more. And as we go forward and as we study this book, we can recognize that God's hand was here because they were seeking the grace and the peace of God in everything they sought to do. And God's hand can be with us too. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I pray just over these words of grace and peace. I pray that your help would be evident to us. And I can't help but think of the picture which John Bunyan gave in Pilgrim's Progress when Christian went out and that he landed in the swamp of despondence. He began to sink first up to his knees, and then he sank up to his neck. He was overwhelmed, and he didn't know what to do. The more that he moved in his own strength, the more that he sank. And it was a sad place. It was a terrible place, and all he could do was call out for help. And a man came running by the name of Help. And he came to Christian and he pulled him out. It is Help who said, I've been sent by the King who is eternal. And I've come here to help you, even though that he was foolish enough to go into the swamp to begin with. I think that's good to remind us that even in foolishness, God still desires to help us. We as a church, we need help. We together as people need your help all the time, and we also pray the peace of God would be a compelling part of our hearts so that we are not anxious or fearful, but we would be readily able to share the good things which you've done. And I really believe when grace and peace is sufficient in our lives and overwhelming us, I do think that that's very attractive to people that don't know you. I think the world is looking for grace. I think it is looking for peace. But we are not going to find it anywhere else until we find it in Jesus. Thank you for you and for this message as we begin in the series. And we love you, Lord. Thank you for all good things. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to change things up for our last song, so I apologize to the tech booth. But if you'll stand and open your blue hymnals to number 105, it's stuck in my head, so we're going to sing it. Hopefully you all know it because we're singing this joyful noise to the Lord without backup music. Mm-hmm. All right, ready? Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt, yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled.
will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Sin and despair like the sea waves cold threaten the soul with infinite loss. Grace that is greater, yes, grace untold, points to the refuge, the mighty cross. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Dark is the stain that we cannot hide. What can avail to wash it away? Look, there is flowing a crimson tide. Whiter than snow you may be today. Grace, grace, God's grace. Grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace. Grace that is greater than all our sin. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see his face, will you this moment his grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin.
Very beautiful way to end our service today. All that we need is grace. So let's close in a word of prayer. Father, if these are the words in which we sing to you, may you be attentive to fulfill this for us. Thank you for your grace. We need it all the time. But if there's anyone sitting here and they need your grace, they're looking for help, always know that you're gentle and kind and you're willing to give it to everybody who's willing to receive it. I just pray that hearts are willing to receive you. Thank you for you and being the Lord over this service today. And we give you all of our best and thank you for leading us in all good things. In Jesus' name, amen. You're dismissed. Pulling out a song on me.